His TED Talk, "Violence Against Women is a Women's Issue, is a Men's Issue," has been viewed more than 2 million times. Katz is a former high school football star. So those of you who are Plant High School proud Panthers on the football team that's won, what, 5 or 6 state championships, he understands what it's like to be a high school football star. And he became the first man at the University of Massachusetts Amherst to earn a minor in women's studies. He holds a master's degree from Harvard Graduate School of Education and a PhD in cultural and cultural studies and education from UCLA. He is a native of Boston, and he lives with his family in the Los Angeles area. Please join me in welcoming my friend, Dr. Jackson Katz.
Good job. Thanks, Mindy. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mindy. Before I begin, I just want to say Mindy Murphy and her colleagues at The Spring, here at an institution here in Tampa, have been incredible for a long, long time in the community and doing all kinds of things, but also in their advocacy in bringing me here and bringing me here today, as well as an extended set of events. And I think they deserve a big round of applause for all their work and leadership. I think, and I know that it's important when men like myself do the work that we do, and I'm going to be sharing with you some of this work this morning, it's important that we acknowledge that the growing movement of men, in a multicultural sense here in the United States and an international sense all over the world, the growing movement of men who are standing up and speaking out about men's violence against women and children and other men, that growing movement of men is indebted to women's leadership and women's advocacy. And I say that because oftentimes the women who have been doing this work don't get the acknowledgement or the support that they deserve. And in fact, a lot of people have this misperception that women who have built, again, institutions like battered women's programs and domestic violence and sexual assault programs and sexual harassment programs and all that, somehow those women have only benefited women and girls. That's a misperception that people have. Men and boys have also been profoundly affected in a positive way by women's leadership in all of this. Men and boys' lives have been profoundly influenced in a very positive way. And sometimes in the public conversation, that doesn't come out. It comes out like, okay, the women have had their movement and the women's, you know, they're helping women and girls, but what about the men and boys? And this is kind of ignorant nonsense. It's like men and boys are embedded in families, in relationships, in peer cultures, in communities with women and girls. So every issue that affects women and girls affects men and boys. So when we improve women and girls' lives, we're improving men and boys' lives. But in addition, so much of the abuse and violence that men commit against not just women, but against other men and boys is also something that we should be talking about and thinking about. And women's leadership, has provided the opportunity for more thoughtful conversations about men's abusive behaviors as well, and men's experience of abuse. And I'm going to talk about all this. But let me ask you another question before I plunge into my, if you will, prepared remarks. Is it going to offend Plant sensibilities if I step out from behind this podium? You won't be offended? You sure? All right, I think I would like to step out from behind the podium. Now, I hope I don't trip over all this, because I like to walk around, but I want to tell you why I asked you the question, if I could step out from behind the podium, because I do a lot of talks and a lot of trainings and all over the United States and parts of the world. And a few years ago, I was in Palm Springs, California to do a 3-hour training for a group of police chiefs from throughout the Southern California region. And that was a great opportunity for someone like me to be in this room with 90 powerful police chiefs. And 97% of them you know, were men, and the vast majority of those men were white men. And when I walked into this conference center, there was a doorway, and I walked over to the podium, and I was standing behind the podium, and I sensed in the body posturing of the chiefs a bit of kind of defensiveness or reluctance or even perhaps some hostility, as if they were saying to me, this is what I was perceiving, you know, what do we have to sit through this, listen to this guy, and 3 hours on this, why is he even here, and why do we have to sit here for 3 hours? I just got the sense that they weren't particularly happy at that moment. So I'm behind the podium, and I thought I would loosen up the crowd, so I said to the chiefs, do you mind if I step out from behind the podium? And one of the chiefs yells out, yeah, it makes you a better target. So it didn't start out particularly well that morning, but I thought it went fine, by the way. It didn't start out very well, but I thought it went fine. And I knew, by the way, the moment that chief had opened his mouth, that he had given me a great gift, which is an anecdote that I could share with you all these years later. So, however, inadvertently, the chief was supporting my work. Now, I don't sense the same level of tension in this room, but then again, I really haven't said anything. And the reason why I'm saying that is because I'm going to say some things that are pretty provocative. And this is serious subject matter. This is dead serious subject matter. We have a pathetically common problem in our society of men assaulting women and children and other men, of domestic violence, of sexual assault, of sexual harassment, of gay bashing, of bullying. We have a big problem. Right? I mean, it's no secret to you all if you're paying any attention. It's a big problem. It's a big problem among young people, too. It's not just adults. Teen relationship abuse is a serious and ongoing problem. I mean, by the way, did anybody pay attention to what's been happening in Sayreville High School in New Jersey? Have you following that case? Anybody follow that case? Where a group of, where the football team in a very successful football program in Sayreville, New Jersey, the superintendent of the school district just canceled the football season, just last week, canceled the football season in the middle of the season because of a series of hazing incidents that's been happening in the high school football team in Sayreville, New Jersey. And not, I think 6 or 7 boys on the team have been criminally charged with sexual assault. Some of you paid attention to this? Have you heard about this? These are boys who are basically sexually assaulting other boys, and there's 6 or 7 of them have been criminally charged. And this is potentially an even bigger story as it unfolds, because it might come out that it's been happening for a lot longer than they thought it might be happening. So the point is, this stuff is real. Spring and others aren't just like making it up or exaggerating we have these problems. These are big problems in our society. And in the short time that I have with you today, I'm going to hopefully push you to think about these issues in a way that maybe you haven't thought about them. And I'm particularly going to say things that I hope are challenging to the men, to the young men here, because I think we need a whole lot more from young men on these issues. We've had lots of women's engagement and leadership at all different levels, in a multicultural sense, in an international sense. Women have been doing incredible things, but there really haven't been enough men who are willing to stand with them and join them and start taking some risks in male culture and speaking out. And that's going to be a big part of my presentation this morning. Now, let me just say the way that I got involved in this work, because it seems to make some sense, because Mindy read my bio, and so you heard that I've done a bunch of different things in the sports culture, in the military, and in all kinds of different settings. And my particular career trajectory is not a particularly traditional one, coming from the background that I came to the work that I did and I do. So I want to share with you briefly a piece of my personal, you know, story. So when I was in college, back in the late, I think it was the Mesozoic era, I get mixed up with those epics, but it was a long time ago. I was living in a co-ed dorm, and it was co-ed by room. In other words, women were my next door neighbors in my on this hall, And I remember how much I was enjoying my freedom, being away from home and coming home from parties 2 a.m. and not really thinking about my personal safety. I'm not saying that it was smart, but I was not thinking about my personal safety, just walking across campus. This is great. I love this. And my female peers living on the same hallway had completely different experience because they were constantly aware of what time it is. Do I have a ride home? Do we have a buddy system? Do we gonna go home together? In other words, their personal safety on a daily basis was something that was concerning to them, and it wasn't something that I was concerned about. And I remember thinking as a man, as a young guy, excuse me, if I had to worry constantly about being sexually assaulted, if I had to constantly have this mental checklist of things that I needed to do because I'm worried that if I'm out past a certain hour, if I'm in a certain place, or I have to worry about, I can't even take a class at night because I don't want to be in a building where, you know, I'm not feeling safe studying or because if there's no guard at the door and all this. Women have all these things that they have to think about on a regular basis. I remember thinking if I had to worry about that stuff, I'd be ticked off about it. I'd be pretty pissed off about it. And I remember as a young journalist, I was a student journalist in college as well, I was covering a rally for women students were protesting trying to get better lighting on campus. And let me just say, on college campuses, 90% of rapes happen inside, and they happen between people who know each other. The perpetrator knows the victim knows the perpetrator in 90% of cases on college campuses. So it's not the typical stranger rape that's the biggest problem, although it does happen. But on my campus, there had been a couple of rapes that happened in a parking lot on the outskirts of campus. Anyways, there was these protests for better lighting in parking lots and other places. And I remember thinking, it is so wrong that women students have to protest to get better lighting. And I also remember thinking, not that these women hated men, that they were hostile to men. That wasn't my feeling. It was, these were leaders. These were people standing up for themselves. They were standing up for other women, for themselves, for other women, and for men who had, everybody has the right to walk free and not be worried about being assaulted. And I saw those women as standing up for that right. And I was impressed by them and inspired by them, as opposed to put off by them. Some guys respond to women who are protesting or speaking out like that in a defensive crouch, like, oh, they just hate men. And mine was more like, you go, girl. That's what leadership looks like. That's what leadership looks like, people standing up for themselves. And I remember thinking, where are the men? Why aren't there men out there? If the vast majority of sexual assault is committed by men, which it is, and the vast majority of men are not rapists, which they are not, the vast majority of men, why aren't there men out there saying, you know what, we need men joining with women to say we need better lighting, we need to do better policies? But there wasn't that many men. In fact, there was no men in this particular protest. And I remember thinking as a young guy, that's on its face wrong. And I thought, I'm going to start speaking out. So that's how it began for me. I just started speaking out, and I was a pretty confident young guy, and I thought, you know, in my sports culture experience, and some of you are student athletes, we always talk about leadership, and you know, leadership is 24/7, leadership is on and off the field. You take a stand, you stand up for what's right. That's what a leader does. And I thought, I'm just going to do it, and that's how it began for me, basically. And then, by the way, when I started talking about this, writing about it and talking about it, I started hearing from women around me, friends, girlfriend at the time, and other women and girls, and I started realizing how much more common these experiences were in women's lives than I had previously been paying attention to. And I was like, oh my God, this is a bigger problem. And by the way, not just the incidents of it, not just the actual women who had themselves been assaulted, but the fear of it, the threat of it, was a regular part of so many women's lives. And again, that just began my process of speaking out. And so I'm today doing what I started doing as a 19-year-old college student. And my hair is a lot shorter, and my clothes are better than they were back in the day. But it's the same basic message. And happily, because of all kinds of stuff that's been happening in the culture, and my work, other people's work, there's a new conversation today happening between men and between men and women that is hopefully transformative. And the situation with the NFL is an example of that. There's a new conversation that's happening in a public space that hasn't really been happening until now. And that's a very positive and promising thing. Now, historically, the issues of gender violence, the issues of domestic violence, relationship abuse, sexual assault, those issues have been seen as women's issues that some good men help out with, right? That's the status quo of so many people's thinking about the issues that I'm talking about. They've been seen as largely women's issues, and there are guys who are good people, or they care, or they have some personal, you know, passion, and they help and support the women. But I'm gonna tell you, that frame is itself part of the problem, and I'm gonna spend a few minutes, just a few, talking about a paradigm shift in our thinking. In other words, we have to think differently about these issues. Instead of seeing them as women's issues that good men help out with, I'm gonna argue that these are men's issues, first and foremost. Now, having said what I just said, that they're men's issues, of course they're also women's issues. I know this. Of course women are directly affected, and like I've said, women have been at the forefront in the leadership against all this stuff. But at the same time, sorry, one of the challenges of clearing your throat when you have a microphone like 3 inches from your mouth is it's not pretty. But give me a second. One of the challenges, again, of doing this work is that because women have been at the forefront, and because so many people see it as women's, front and center concern, a lot of guys kind of tune it out. In other words, one of the reasons why it's a problem to call relationship abuse and sexual assault a women's issue is a lot of men hear the term women's issue, and we tend to think, you know, that's not our issue. That's for the girls, or that's for the women, and I'm a guy. And a lot of men literally don't get beyond the first sentence. It's almost like a chip in our brain is activated, and the neural pathways take our attention in a different direction when we hear the term women's issues. And by the way, this is true of the word gender as well, because a lot of people hear the word gender, and they think it means women. So they think that gender issues is synonymous with women's issues. There's some confusion about the term gender. And let me illustrate that confusion by way of analogy. So let's talk for a moment about race, okay? So in the United States, a lot of people, when they hear the word race, they tend to think it means African American, Latino, Asian American, Native American, South Asian, Pacific Islander. Or people, when they hear the word sexual orientation, they tend to think it means gay, lesbian, bisexual. And a lot of people, when they hear the word gender, they tend to think it means women. In each case, the dominant group doesn't get paid attention to, right? As if white people don't have some sort of racial identity or belong to some racial category. As if heterosexual people don't have a sexual orientation. As if men don't have a gender. This is one of the ways that dominant systems maintain and reproduce themselves, which is to say the dominant group is rarely challenged to even think about its dominance, because that's one of the key characteristics of power and privilege, which is to say the ability to go unexamined, lacking introspection or self-awareness. In fact, the powerful are often rendered invisible in parts of the conversation about issues that are often largely about us. And I'll illustrate what I mean by giving you a handful of examples in the domestic and sexual violence context. Okay, so you'll hear people ask questions like this. They'll say things like, how many women were raped on college campuses in the United States last year, rather than how many men raped women on college campuses last year? You'll hear people say things like, in the Tampa school district, how many teen girls were harassed or abused last year, rather than how many boys harassed or abused girls, or how many girls harassed or abused girls. You'll hear people say things like, in the state of Florida, how many teenage girls got pregnant last year, rather than how many men and boys impregnated teenage girls. In each case, the use of the passive voice has a very powerful political effect. And the political effect is the shift in focus off of men and boys and onto girls and women. Are you following me here? This is deep, because language structures thought, and the way that we form sentences literally shapes how we think. And by asking questions in the passive voice and talking about how many women are raped rather than how many men rape women, it again keeps our focus on women and off of men. Even the term violence against women is a term that I don't use. What's missing from the term violence against women? Men, in other words, the active agent is missing. in the linguistic, in linguistic terms. Violence against women is a bad thing that happens to women, but nobody's doing it to them. They're just kind of experiencing it, like the weather. But if you insert the active agent, men, you have a new phrase, men's violence against women. It doesn't roll off the tongue as easily, but it's more accurate. It's more honest. And by the way, is it anti-male to be honest? Is it bashing men to just tell the truth that we have a problem in our society of men assaulting women? I mean, I just don't get that. I don't get how some guys get defensive in the face of literally honest, accurate language and conversation. I just don't get it. As a man, for example, when I hear women who are angry about and upset about, and understandably angry and upset about, all the abuse and harassment that women experience at the hands of men, I don't get defensive and think, oh, they hate men, they're bashing men. I think, okay, as a man, what can I do to help prevent this from happening? Because it's obviously a problem. It's not like defensive. I mean, when guys get defensive, to me, it says so much more about them than it does about who the women are or what the women are saying. It says so much more about either their ignorance or the fragility of their ego or something. Because to me, it's just so obvious that what these women are saying is true and it's something that needs to be addressed. And by the way, the same system that produces men who abuse women produces men who abuse other men. As I referenced in that Sayreville, New Jersey case, it's like men are assaulting each other. Boys and men bully each other, not just women and girls. And men assault each other. And men murder each other. I mean, in most of the major categories of violence in our society, guess who the primary victims are? With the exception of sexual violence, the primary victims of most forms of interpersonal violence are men and boys. Murder, attempted murder, assault, aggravated assault, bullying, gay bashing, all of them, men are the primary victims and the primary perpetrators. Because the same system, again, that produces men who mistreat girls and women produces men who mistreat boys and other men. It's not one or the other. It's both at the same time. So I hope the guys hear what I'm saying here. It's not anti-male to just get honest about what's going on and try to figure out, okay, what is going on in male culture? How are we socializing boys? Why is this happening? Is it genetic? Is it just inevitable that guys are going to do this and act out in these ways? Or is there something that we can do about it? And I think it's obvious there's something we can do about it. We can do so much better than we're doing as a society in all of this. So much better. Now, I've been saying that these are men's issues, not just women's issues that men help out with. I'm also going to argue that these are leadership issues for men. And I want to develop that point briefly. What do I mean when I say that? Well, I mean that if you're a man and you're a leader, and you're a young man and you're aspiring to be a leader, by definition of that leadership, you need to know about all these issues that I'm talking about. And again, this is just an assembly. This is just one talk. I mean, there's so much more to learn. But you need to know about this stuff, and then you need to figure out what you can do about it and how you can affect your sphere of influence, whatever that might be. Not because you're a nice guy helping out the women, but because you're a leader. And we need leaders in our society, especially in this case, men and young men, who have the courage and the strength to engage with these issues. And if we got to the place where boys and young men, and men more generally, across class and race and all kinds of other social categories, if we got to the place where it was understood that if you're a young guy who wants to be a leader and aspires to that, that this is going to be part of your portfolio, this is going to be part of the stuff that you address as a leader, then we would begin to see a significant change in our society. And in my work with men, in the sports culture, in the military, in schools and colleges, this is part of the pitch, if you will, to men. It's not that we're going in and saying, you're a bad guy, you better stop doing bad things. It's more like, come on, we need more men with the courage and strength to start standing up and being leaders on this subject. Because boys and men need to hear from other boys and men about this kind of talk and this kind of subject area, not just from women. And I'm going to share with you an example of men's leadership that you don't see that often in the public conversation in the United States around these issues. Now, this is not actually a United States example, but it's related in a weird way. I'm gonna just give you the context for what I'm about to show you, okay? So I work with the U.S. military. I've been working with all the services, and my colleagues have been, since 1997. Shockingly long time. But we've been working with the Australian Army for the past 2 years. Is there anybody here who's from Australia? Anybody by any chance? Any Aussies in the house? All right. Are you an exchange student or you moved here? Okay. Excellent, okay. Is there anybody here who's been to Australia? Is there anybody who plans at one point in your long life to go to Australia? Okay. All right. Australia is a great country, and it's very interesting, and it's very far away, but it's very interesting. I've been there a lot. But so we've been working with the Australian Army for the past 2 years, and I want to give you the context for what I'm about to show you. About roughly 2 years ago, there was a scandal that erupted in the Australian Army. What happened was a group of junior enlisted leaders and then junior officers were posting a series of really sexist and sexually degrading Facebook posts and emails, and making really derogatory comments about female peers and other women. And of course they got caught, because this is the digital age and you get caught when you do stupid things like that. And so even though it's also ethically problematic what they did, or morally problematic, it's also really stupid, because it's the digital age and you get caught. Anyways, they got caught, and it became a media scandal, and the chief of staff of the Australian Army, a man by the name of General David Morrison, was of course upset about it, and he issued a statement, a videotaped statement that went out to all the members of the Australian Army in response, and this video then went viral beyond. And I'm going to now share with you the clip of General David Morrison making a statement in response to this scandal in the Australian Army. So Kurt, if you could roll the Chief of Army, please.
Earlier today, I addressed the media and through them the Australian public about ongoing investigations into a group of officers and NCOs whose conduct, if proven, has not only brought the Australian Army into disrepute, but has let down every one of you and all of those whose past service has won the respect of our nation. There are limits to how much I can tell you, because the investigations into this network by both the New South Wales Police and the ADF Investigative Service are ongoing. But evidence collected to date has identified a group of men within our ranks who have allegedly produced highly inappropriate material demeaning women and distributed it across the internet and Defence's email networks. If this is true, then the actions of these members are in direct contravention to every value the Australian Army stands for. By now, I assume you know my attitude to this type of conduct. I have stated categorically many times that the Army has to be an inclusive organisation in which every soldier, man and woman, is able to reach their full potential and is encouraged to do so. Those who think that it is okay to behave in a way that demeans or exploits their colleagues have no place in this Army. Our service has been engaged in continuous operations since 1999 and in its longest war ever in Afghanistan. On all operations, female soldiers and officers have proven themselves worthy of the best traditions of the Australian Army. They are vital to us maintaining our capability now and into the future. If that does not suit you, then get out. You may find another employer where your attitude and behaviour is acceptable, but I doubt it. The same goes for those who think that toughness is built on humiliating others. Every one of us is responsible for the culture and reputation of our Army and the environment in which we work. If you become aware of any individual degrading another, then show moral courage and take a stand against it. No one has ever explained to me how the exploitation or degradation of others enhances capability or honours the traditions of the Australian Army. I will be ruthless in ridding the Army of people who cannot live up to its values, and I need every one of you to support me in achieving this. The standard you walk past is the standard you accept. That goes for all of us, but especially those who by their rank have a leadership role. If we are a great national institution, if we care about the legacy left to us by those who have served before us, if we care about the legacy we leave to those who, in turn, will protect and secure Australia, then it is up to us to make a difference. If you're not up to it, find something else to do with your life. There is no place for you amongst this band of brothers and sisters.
So can you imagine if we lived in a society where it was normal to hear men in positions of institutional leadership and cultural authority like that talk like that normally? If it wasn't unusual, if it was a common thing, because I can imagine what would it be like. You know what it would be like? We'd have much less violence in our society. We'd have much less interpersonal abuse and sexual assault and relationship abuse and bashing and gay bashing and bullying. You know why? Because the typical perpetrator of these crimes is not a sick man, he's not a sociopath, he's not mentally ill or deeply disturbed. Of course there are those individuals, but the typical perpetrator is much more normal than that. Much more normal than that. You think those guys in Sayreville, New Jersey, when you start looking at the histories of the boys who are now charged with sexual assault, you think it's going to come out that they're somehow sociopaths or, you know, kind of Freddy Krueger characters? They're going to be normal guys who played football and they had families and all that kind of stuff, but they were caught up in a certain kind of idea about what's cool, what's not cool, what's acceptable, what's not acceptable. This makes people uncomfortable, by the way. The fact that most of the abuse that happens in our society is being perpetrated by normal guys, average guys in every other way, that makes people very uncomfortable. Because I think a lot of people would prefer that it was kind of sick, twisted individuals, because then we wouldn't have to take responsibility for being part of a society that produces these individuals. Because if it's just like some whack job or some crazy guy or some, you know, like I said, monster, then there's nothing much we can do about it. But the reality is there's a lot we can do about it because the average guy who does it is much more normal, which means that he's connected to our communities, he's connected to the same kind of belief systems that most of us are connected to. And again, that makes a lot of people uncomfortable. But you know what? Being a leader means going into uncomfortable spaces. Being a leader means being willing to say, you know what, this is going to be a little bit awkward. Some of this stuff is, I'm going to have to, as a guy, for example, I'm going to have to think about ways that I might be participating in parts of the society that are contributing to this problem, even if I myself aren't committing acts of aggression and abuse. But I might be doing things, I might be participating in parts of male culture or female culture that contribute to the problem. And that's not very comforting to some people, and they'd rather just like, oh, they're just crazy, they're just they got some problems, and that's not I think an honest way to assess what's really going on. Now I'm going to share with you the approach that I and my colleagues developed for working on these issues. It's called the bystander approach, and it's a conceptual shift in the field, if you will, of preventing interpersonal abuse and violence that we've been engaged in now for quite a while. I'm just going to give you the highlights of it because we don't have a whole lot of time. I just want to share with you the way that everybody, men and women, boys and girls, can participate in a positive way in trying to change the cultural norms that contribute to these problems. And I'm going to use the board here just for to illustrate this point. Back in the day, back in the 70s and 80s, way back from your perspective, like ancient times, the way that most people understood gender violence prevention, preventing sexual assault and preventing relationship abuse, people's understanding was organized around this binary. The binary is women and men. You know these symbols, by the way? what's this symbol? What's this a symbol of? Women? Men, okay. Do you know where this comes from, by the way, in Roman mythology? Anybody know in Roman mythology what these symbols represent? Very good, Venus and Mars. Venus is the goddess of love. The symbol of femininity is Venus, the goddess of love, and Mars, the symbol of masculinity, was the god of war. So from ancient times, from antiquity, the symbol of masculinity was violence, the symbol of femininity, love, and physical beauty. So we get some deeply rooted ideas about masculinity and femininity that have to be critically examined, don't you think? Anyways, back in the day, most efforts to prevent assault and abuse were focused on women and girls. And they were called prevention efforts, but they were really risk reduction efforts, teaching girls things like, don't put your drink down at a party, like on college campuses or in high school. Don't put your drink down at a party because a guy might drop a rape drug in it. Or look in the back seat of your car before you get in. Or have a man's voice on the voicemail. Or have the buddy system. Check in with your friends. Or note the warning signs in abuse in relationships. Like if you're a girl and you're in a relationship with a guy and he's making every decision about the kind of clothing you can wear, who your friends can be, the kind of movies you can go see together, this is bad because he's already controlling you. And that controlling behavior could be leading to physical abuse, because one of the typical patterns in relationship abuse is non-physical forms of controlling behaviors graduating into physical forms of controlling behavior. You follow me on this? Most abuse in relationships that we talk about as domestic violence, it's about control and force that's used to gain or maintain that control. Anyways, most efforts that have been talked about as prevention back in the day were focused on women and girls and how could they could note the warning signs, how they could reduce situations of potential harm. That's not prevention. That's risk reduction. Because prevention means going to the root cause of the problem. And the root cause of the problem is not girls and women. And by the way, I know there are some girls and women who are abusive, that perpetuate abuses of different kinds. I'm not naive about this, but the vast majority of the abuse is being perpetrated by men and young men. That's just a fact. And that's what I'm focusing on this morning. Back in the day, when men were the focus, it was almost always as perpetrators or potential perpetrators. So in other words, the way that men were spoken to was like, and I was one of those men as a young guy, it was the kind of message to guys was like, you guys better listen up. Or, you know, if you don't listen to people like us, we know that some of you will be doing these kind of bad things. And you need to know, for example, what consent means and what the law says. The state of Florida says if you have, you know, if you cross a line and you're pushing forward and having sex with a person, with a woman or a man, a girl or a boy, who is not consenting in various ways because she or he is not old enough or because he or she is inebriated or drunk, etc., you could be committing rape. And you need to know what those lines are and don't cross them. And as an educator, as a young guy, and I was in my 20s developing my sort of conceptual framework for the prevention work that I was intending to do, I'm an educator, right? I wasn't a law enforcement person, so I didn't like the idea of coming into a room and telling people don't cross the line, especially talking to men like that. I just didn't think it was a particularly effective approach. Even though I respect the role that law enforcement plays in all this, it's just not the same. When you want buy-in, in other words, you want guys and girls, everybody, to buy into something, telling them don't do it is not necessarily the best strategy. So the question was, what do you do? Okay, what do you do? How do you get more men involved? So back in the early 90s, which is still a long time ago for all you, but for me it seems like I can't believe it's so long. I can't believe the years go by so quickly. And by the way, they'll go by quickly for you, too. So you might laugh at me and think, oh, this old guy, you know, fine. You're going to be in my position, if you're lucky, one day. And you'll think, oh, where did it go? Where did it go? I can't believe how fast life gets. It's crazy. Anyways, so in the early 90s, I'm in graduate school in Boston. Anybody here been to Boston? Does anybody have a life goal to go to Boston? You don't have to answer that. So I'm in graduate school in Boston, and I had this idea for a program that would train, initially, college male student athletes to speak out about sexual assault and relationship abuse. And my thought was not that there was a problem in college athletics or athletics more generally of men assaulting women, although there was a problem of male athletes assaulting women, and there is a problem of male athletes assaulting women. It wasn't about the problem that drew me to think about this. It was the positive leadership platform that student athletes have in your peer culture and their peer culture, in the college world, certainly in the professional world, all this attention that's being focused on the professional athletics is because of how powerful athletics is, how important it is in our society. And I knew all of this, and I thought, you know what, if we can get some guys in the sports culture who already have a leadership platform to start taking some risks and speaking out, it'll make it easier for other guys who aren't as, don't have as much status. So it was a positive way of approaching the sports culture rather than, like I said, a negative one. And so I worked with the director of this institute at Northeastern University called the Center for the Study of Sport and Society. There's a longer story, but the short version of it is I worked with the director of that institute to develop a grant proposal. We ended up getting funded by the United States Department of Education to create a model program, and we had this great opportunity. We had this three-year grant with nine schools, University of Kentucky, Division I athletic programs like that, and small liberal arts schools were included in the first wave of schools. So we had this opportunity to work with all these athletic programs. And the question was, what are we going to do? How are we going to frame the issues for the young men and college football teams, hockey, basketball, baseball, soccer, et cetera? How are we going to frame the issues in a way that invites men into the conversation rather than indicts them as potential rapists? And so what we did is, instead of focusing on women as victims or men as perpetrators, or men as victims and women as perpetrators, we focused on all of us as what we call bystanders. And a bystander is defined as a friend, a teammate, a classmate, a colleague, a coworker, a family member. In other words, anybody who's not either a perpetrator or a victim, but anybody who is in peer cultures with people who might be acting in abusive ways or might be experiencing abuse. What can everybody do, boys, girls, men, women, to challenge and interrupt abuse and to support victims and potential victims so that everybody has a role to play? Now, when I say we need to get specific, we need guys who are willing to start challenging and interrupting other guys when they're acting in certain ways. I don't just mean at the point of attack. I'm not just saying that guys need to, at the moment that their friend is beating up his girlfriend, they need to go over to him and pull him off, you know? It's not like that, right? I mean, that would be a good thing to do, but I'm not saying that that's a realistic model, okay? It's much broader than just at the point of attack. And most domestic violence, most relationship abuse, most sexual violence takes place in private, not in public. So, you know, what do you do if that's the case? Well, if you can take a leap of imagination and imagine that this triangle here is a pyramid, and imagine that this tip of the pyramid is an incident of abuse, like a relationship abuse incident or a sexual assault incident. But the base of the pyramid, much broader, is a set of attitudes, beliefs, and behaviors that create the cultural foundation within which the abusive act takes place. Then you have a whole lot more space to operate in. And I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. So you're a guy, right? You're a plant high school student, and you're a guy. And you're in a group of guys, and there's no girls present. You're just in a group of guys. And one or two of the guys start making really sexist comments about girls, really degrading comments about those bitches and the women, you know, all kinds of negative stuff about girls and women. And you're in the room, and there's no women there, no girls. What do you do? What do you say? And if you don't say anything, what are you saying? To use an analogy, you're a white person. You're in a group of white kids, and there's no people of color in the room. And a couple of the white kids start making racist comments, talking smack or talking trash about people of color in various racist ways. You don't say something? You don't say, hey, what are you talking about? That's racist. You can't say like that. In a sense, isn't your silence a form of consent and complicity in their racism? Or, by the way, if you're a heterosexual person and you're with a group of heterosexual people and some of the other people in the room are saying things that are degrading about, you know, gay people or lesbians or other people of a varying sexual orientation, and you don't say anything, you don't just like, I'm not going to get involved, I'm not going to, you know. In a sense, isn't your silence a form of consent and complicity in their heterosexism? This is pretty basic stuff. And if you're a man and you yourself don't hurt women, you treat women with respect, you don't push, shove, mistreat emotionally, physically, sexually, or anything, girls and women. But you don't say anything when other guys are acting sexist or acting abusive in some way. In a sense, isn't your silence a form of consent and complicity in their sexism? You know, Martin Luther King, one of the great things he said among the many great things that he said in his very short life, you know, he was murdered at age 39. Martin Luther King said, in the end, what'll hurt the most is not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. In the end, what'll hurt the most is not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Pretty deep, isn't it? And the premise here is pretty simple, which is there's been an awful lot of silence in our culture, especially among men, not exclusively, especially among men, and it's time to break that silence. It's time for more men to be willing to say, you know what? I agree, abuse is wrong, and I, as a man, I'm going to take some stance against it, and I'm going to challenge one of my friends are participating in some way in contributing to that culture that's producing this abuse. I'm not going to remain silent. Everything from, you know, rape jokes or sexist comments to actual physical mistreatment. I'm not going to stand for it, and I'm going to stand against it. Pretty basic stuff. That's basically the bystander approach, and it's caught on in a big way. I don't know if you know this, but it's now become the mainstream of the field, and even the White House just recently released a campaign called It's On Us. I don't know if you heard about this. It's called It's On Us, and you can go to itsonus.org, I think, if you're interested on the web and see the beginning of their public service announcements. And the It's On Us campaign, sponsored by the White House, is based on my approach here, the bystander approach. I was a consultant to that campaign. So it's becoming much more prominent. And now in the NFL and in Major League Baseball and the NBA, there's all this foment, and my colleagues and I are working with all those organizations trying to figure out how we can leverage this moment of attention and public pressure to really go to the next level. But the way, as far as I'm concerned, to do this is to bring everybody into the conversation. This is not just about one individual who's abusive. It's about how do you change systems that tolerate the abuse, and that's what this approach is about. Now, we only have a couple more minutes. I'm thinking on my feet here. Should we show one clip, or should we? Okay, so I'm gonna show you one clip, okay? So, because I make films, right? One of the things that I do is I make films. And I just want to share with you one brief clip from one of my most recent films. And when I say films, these are documentary, you know, educational documentaries. And this particular clip deals with media representations of men. And I'm saying this is kind of a quick segue into, because, you know, there's a lot more to where all this comes from. But I just want to give you a glimpse at how powerful it is to look at media in a critical way, because media helps to shape the kind of norms in our society for what it means to be a man or a woman. And this particular clip is just a teaser. I just wanted to share this with you just so you have an inkling of how important it is to look critically at media, because your generation and mine are just completely drenched in media. And media is the great social norming force of our time. You have to be critical. You have to think critically about media. And part of my work is trying to do that, especially about the way that men are represented. And so this particular clip deals with that. And I'm just going to show it to you, and then we'll come back and say goodbye, okay? So, Kurt, if you could roll the... This is from the update of my first film, which is called Tough Guys. Guys is spelled G-U-I-S-E. Tough Guys, like disguise. And this is a clip that shows how the representations of masculinity in media have gotten increasingly aggressive and big and strong over the last several decades. So if you could roll Upping the Ante 2014, please.
The American ideal of the real man owes a lot to the Hollywood Western and the ultimate icon of white American masculinity, John Wayne.
Young fella, if you're looking for trouble, I'll accommodate you.
While other men talked a lot, thought too much, equivocated, and showed emotion, John Wayne made the world bend to his will with just a stare, a few words, his fists, and his guns.
I haven't lost my temper in 40 years, but Pilgrim, you caused a lot of trouble this morning. Might have got somebody killed, and somebody ought to belt you in the mouth. But I won't. I won't. The hell I will.
won't get away with it, Cody.
Cody, huh? You've got a good memory for names. Joe Good.
And then there's Hollywood gangster films with cinematic tough guys like James Cagney and Humphrey Bogart.
Don't move out of you, son. Now fill your pants full of lead. Get over there.
Men hardened by the world who knew the power of a few clipped words and a few rounds of ammunition.
Humphrey Bogart, James Cagney. They pitched me to talk. I like those guys.
Come on. And this equation between toughness, manhood, and violence has continued and in many ways intensified over time.
Say hello to my little friend!
There's no question that over the past few decades, there's been a ratcheting up of what it takes to be considered a real man. Look at our action heroes. In the 1950s, Superman was the equivalent of an ordinary guy running around in tights and a cape. And today, he's pumped up and ripped. Well, look at Batman. The body of Adam West as Batman in the 1960s is a far cry from the far more imposing Dark Knight of the 21st century. Pro wrestlers' bodies in the 1960s were more flabby. In the 21st century, they're way more sculpted, pumped up, and ripped. And look at toy action figures. If you look at the Star Wars toy figurines that kids played with in the 1970s and contrast them with the Star Wars toy figurines that are being marketed to kids today, you see a dramatic shift. Well, look at the body of G.I. Joe. A study done in the late 1990s found that over the past 50 years, the size of G.I. Joe's biceps in real-life equivalents increased from 12.2 inches in 1964 to 15.2 inches in 1974 to 16.4 inches in 1994 and up to 26.8 inches by 1998. If you wanted a comparison to a real person, the biceps of someone like The Rock are reportedly only about 20 inches. Over the same time period, there's been a ratcheting up of violence itself. We've gone from pistols in the 1940s to larger weaponry in the 1970s to the increasing militarization of these weapons in the 80s and 90s to the larger-than-life heavy metal killing machines we have today.
You mustn't be afraid to dream a little bigger, darling.
Say hello to my little friend!
We've seen video game violence go from the benign aggressions of Pac-Man, Space Invaders, and Asteroids to the unimaginable and hyper-realistic bloodbaths of today's game. We've gone from the comparatively orderly sport of boxing to today's number one fighting sport, the street fighting viciousness of mixed martial arts and cage fighting.
Oh! Wow!
All right. Wait, hang on. So, by the way, at the same time that images of men have been getting bigger and more brutal, and again, I know there's counter examples, these are general themes and trends. Images of women in the media system have gotten thinner, smaller, younger, and more highly sexualized. And again, there's counterexamples. But these are important trends because if you study media critically, you'll see that that this stuff is not disconnected to what's happening in the society at large. There's a direct relationship between the image system and what we're producing and selling as images of men and of women and everything else, and what's happening on the ground in real life. So this is just that was just a glimpse at, I hope you were interested in it, at how powerful it can be if you take a critical lens to media, in this case, in the representation of men and women. Again, I'm not making the claim that guys are watching videos or playing video games or whatever, and then imitating what they've seen. That's not how it works. Media is deeper than that. It's about enshrining certain ideas and belief systems about manhood, about womanhood, about what's appropriate, about sex, about race, and all kinds of other things. That's why it's important to study it critically and not just be a robotic consumer who goes and buys the ticket to the movie and walks through the turnstile and buys the product tie-ins. You want to think critically. because media has such a powerful role. And by the way, let me just say, pornography is an incredibly influential part of media. That's another example of how media helps to shape norms. And those boys, you're gonna, if you find out, if you do some research into that Sayreville, New Jersey case, you're gonna find that pornography played a powerful role in what those boys did to each other, in the sexual violence they committed. I'm telling you, I know more about the case than I can talk about right now. So, let me just say, in conclusion, I know Principal Nelson is about to take over. And by the way, I want to thank Principal Nelson as well for his leadership in making this possible. All right. Let me just say, in conclusion, and I appreciate having had this opportunity with you all, I hope that what I've said has sparked you to think about some of this stuff in a way that if you hadn't thought about it before, you're now thinking about it. It's only the beginning of a conversation. By the way, this is not a comprehensive treatment. There's lots more. And I hope going forward, and I'll make available to you and to Principal Nelson some literature and study guides and stuff like that if you want to be discussing this in subsequent discussions in classes and other things. But I hope that your generation has more success in addressing these issues than my generation has had. And I hope there's some people here at Plant, young men and young women, who are part of your generation who take on the challenge of addressing these issues in a way that takes the conversation to the next level. Because as I said at the beginning, there's just too much abuse and violence in our society. It doesn't need to be this way. If more people were engaged and thoughtful and taking some risks and being leaders, we would have many fewer problems, and there'd be a lot less suffering as a result. And I wish you all the best in that endeavor.
Right, let's give him a round of applause. Dr. Katz.
Thank you.
All right.